The redevelopment of the Heygate Estate has been a point of controversy for over a decade now. As it nears completion, its relationship between architecture, media representation and social displacement becomes more pertinent as similar projects take place across the capital. London has experienced a housing crisis for many decades now, but the Heygate Estate raises issues around housing that are unique, not usually discussed beyond typical topics of private developers and the number of homes being built. Beginning with the demonisation of a community whilst also fetishising elements of its so-called urban culture, the Heygate Estate redevelopment is now commodifying elements of that culture for a new, apparently more, respectable class citizen. This is the speculative property market and social displacement in a hyper-modern era, a neocolonial approach to the gentrification of London. Demolition on the Heygate began in 2011 after years of impassioned debate. It was as if the demolition was impervious to its symbolism in the media as a key battleground in the capital's changing housing landscape. The estate had gained a morphology beyond its everyday realities, a political tool for those with an aversion for long, horizontal council housing. This was a myth that had been decades in the making, creating an image that somehow concrete was solely responsible for creating no-go zones in the capital. Over many years, this image was moulded by mainstream media, politicians and popular culture that was filmed on the Heygate. Films such as Shank, Harry Brown and A Veteran were all filmed there, making it a popular film location for violent action films. The BBC and the Evening Standard even described it as a mugger's paradise. The inner city realities of precarious work and the lack of opportunities were constantly exploited, creating an exaggerated image of an estate for those who would never even visit it. And yet, parts of popular culture were fetishising the urban nature of the estate at the same time, prominently used as the location of David Guetta's Love Don't Let Me Go music video. The Heygate Estate was used as a shorthand for a lifestyle filled with inner city grittiness. The nation's media had depicted the estate as filled with endless corridors of uncertainty, with danger lurking at any moment. But David Guetta's world was different. Parkour animates the estate, with people leaping from one walkway to the next. This is a mythical world far from the realities of the estate, and even further away from how it was depicted by other mainstream media. The football cages, the long horizontal buildings, the concrete, they were all there, but somehow it all felt so different. Along with the parkour is the naughty streetwear, a lot of it baggy and almost torn. Somehow, everyone is white. Had anyone working on the video ever been to the Heygate before? It's reassuringly commodifying and slightly challenging aesthetic. This was inner city edginess, but with a respectable veneer. This was a music video fetishising the estate, in sharp contrast to how it was generally depicted in the news. With two such different images of the estate from the outside, what was the Heygate actually even like?
The estate was completed in 1974, providing over 1,200 homes for more than 3,000 people. It was composed of four tall perimeter buildings that enclosed 10 masonette blocks within. Roads and cars were separated from pedestrians, with one looping road circling the site. Fast mature greenery and play spaces sat between the masonette blocks. As was typical of similar estates of the time, elevated pedestrian walkways connected all the blocks at first floor level, creating another layer of circulation overlooking the ground floor level. The architecture of the individual blocks is not particularly remarkable. The estate's defining characteristic was the use of deck access from the outward face of each of the tall wall-like block, unapologetically expressing their horizontality. Elsewhere, the architectural language was restrained, humble and flat, predominantly constructed using panelised precast concrete. As the architecture presents itself as a monolith, the estate's multiplicity of meanings are often mythologised into a singular, coherent story. However, there was never a coherence to the Heygate. From the residents who fondly remember their community and the greenery, to residents who witness crime, it is easy to fetishise this place from one extreme to the other, where the reality is that big places inevitably contain diverse experiences and a wide range of stories. The ultimate downfall of the estate is where the residents were let down by the narrative swirling around them, making them feel like they were under continuous scrutiny. One film with a more subversive approach to filming on the Heygate Estate was Attack the Block. Released in 2011, director Joe Cornish wanted to counter the trend of hoodie horror films which demonised urban youth. Cornish used his sci-fi comedy horror to show a different side of London's estate culture. With an alien invasion taking place on the estate, a group of teenage boys is left to defend their community in a drama filled with London slang, cadence and humour.
What kind of alien would invade some shitty council estate in South London?
This was a post-apocalyptic world like some of the other films that filmed on the Heygate, yet this time the residents come together to fight the alien invasion. Although the film features two stars at the beginning of their careers in John Boyega and Jodie Whittaker, this was not a box office hit. Its impact was humble, but to some extent, Attack the Block paved the way for popular TV shows, such as Chewing Gum and Top Boy, to go on to portray the complexity of life on London's estates. Its role in reclaiming the perception of London's council estates is still, to this day, a significant one, magnifying everyday estate culture of a generally multicultural London. The film makes commentary on policing and the negative perceptions of youth on London's estates. The character arc of Samantha, played by Jodie Whittaker, takes her from wanting to punish the boys for mugging her to, by the end of the film, sincerely calling them her neighbours and looking out for them.
So Attack the Block is definitely trying to do something similar. It has a social subtext. It's trying to say something about the way we think about kids like that and the way we think about people who live in places like that.
Architecture is often discussed as the cause of these negative perceptions, particularly in dense urban areas. Yet the relationship of architectural form and the expression of societal values has been little discussed when it comes to the Heygate Estate. The Heygate was unapologetically horizontal in form, with vast linear blocks up to 200 metres in length. It is surely no accident that what is to replace the old estate is predominantly vertical in form, a common characteristic of London's current generation of redevelopments. Long horizontal buildings are made possible by large, open and predominantly flat sites, with space to extend into. Historically, these have been state-owned, where amenity triumphs over profit. Along with their associations to the radical post-war housing boom, long horizontal buildings have a strong connection to a European socialist project. Meanwhile, the tower has always had connotations of capitalist ego, maximising economic value on a small, tight site. In short, the vertical building can be read as the expression of a hierarchical society, with the horizontal building an expression of an egalitarian one. The Heygate's critics normally use concrete as its symbol of a failing society. And yet, within the subtext, is the rejection of an ideological expression that is outwardly egalitarian. The irony is that the private developer Lendlease has acquired this large site that could still accommodate horizontal wall buildings, but is instead holding on to its ideologically formed capitalist towers. Beyond the rejection of working class people and their culture, it appears that the redevelopment's aim was to remove the concrete expression of an egalitarian society.
With the opening of the Tate Modern in 2000, along with the Shard in 2012, Southwark Council has been striving to transform the image of the borough to one that is an intrinsic part of central London. Elephant and Castle forms a crucial part of this vision, with £1.5 billion to redevelop the area.
What they were trying to do was to introduce a better class of people to the Elephant and Castle. A better class of people. Well, I said, you can't get a better class of people than us.
Where there used to be 1,200 socially rented units in the Heygate Estate, the redevelopment will have a meagre 82. Southwark Council spent £51 million on evicting the estate's residents, but they only sold the land to Lendlease for £50 million. Lendlease will profit up to nearly £200 million from the redevelopment, with Southwark Council receiving nothing from that. Some residents have had to move far out of London to find similarly affordable housing. Social displacement normally takes subtle forms over many decades, but this was a council-engineered programme that only took a few short years. A large proportion of the redevelopment was sold off-plan to overseas investors before they were even built or went on the market in London, proving that this was not a project aiming to create a new elephant and castle community. The architecture of the redevelopment is mediocre at best, featuring the usual glassy towers combined with New London vernacular blocks. With no clear unifying visual language across the site, the redevelopment is committed to hiding any trace of the Heygate's history, and that this is all owned by a single developer. This specific use of the New London vernacular to displace a settled community takes on a sinister appearance, with the thinly veiled brick slip projecting an image of polite respectability for this process. This, combined with a lazy liberal approach to diversity in the marketing material, means that all the redevelopment aims to do is profit from a cleaned up version of the area's multicultural history. Any sense of local identity has been packaged in a way palatable for glossy marketing material. In this context, the New London vernacular becomes an oppressive architectural tool, erasing London's expression of everyday culture. With a community that has been demonised, fetishised, and now displaced, the Heygate Estate redevelopment will in part exploit and profit from those who have transformed the negative perceptions of London's housing estates. Hiding behind the new shiny glass and respectable use of brick, the Heygate redevelopment is a neo-colonial housing project, one that is being replicated across the capital.